What's your name?
Perla Scott.
Okay. Perleska?
Perla Scott.
Perla.
Yes.
Scott. Okay. Perla, you're here today at this protest on Monsanto. Why are you protesting Monsanto?
I just want to know that what I have in my plate is safe. That's it.
Okay.
It's so very simple.
And what do you define as safe?
Something that's not going to poison me and my family.
And do you believe that Monsanto is producing food that's poisonous?
Yeah, absolutely.
If
they're not poisoning us, why don't they want to label them? It's okay. That simple. Let us know what we're eating. That's it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, I'm Steve. What's your name?
My name is Omatli.
Omatli.
Omatli. Omatli. O-M-A-T-L-I.
Okay.
Omatli.
And you are?
Cuauhtémoc.
Oh boy. Okay, gentlemen. And you're here today, and you're here to protest Monsanto. Why are you protesting Monsanto?
Well, you know, we all have our own personal reasons, but my personal reason is that through my experience and all the things I've learned, you know, along the way, and you know, coming to protest, you know, it's everybody's right to know what's in their food. You know, food. I think food is used as a weapon against the people. We don't know exactly what's being put inside the food. So I don't want to be eating poison. You know, food is, it's like a corporation now. It's a business, and that's what Monsanto is. And food isn't a business. Food is something sacred that you should respect. We should all have the right to grow our own food. You can't label, you can't trademark, you can't put any stamp on a vegetable that belongs to the land and say it's yours, just the way Monsanto does with the corn and the seeds. So that's why I'm here, to protect for what belongs to the people, not to a corporation.
Yes, sir?
Yeah, like my brother said, it's really important for us to be out here, because if it's not us, it won't be nobody else. And it's the food is the number one thing we're supposed to be taking care of. And obviously, it's about it all comes down to the corn. They do all these tests with the animals, they poison them, and then they get like mutated, and we end up eating it. A lot of people don't really know what's in the food. And yeah, it's really, really important. We're here to give out our point of views. Hope other people will follow and listen and take a little advice, because you always have to know what you're eating before you eat it, or else you're axed out.
And you're wearing a mask today. Is your mask symbolic of anything?
Not necessarily. Just, in a way it does. It's poisoning our food.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Can I share one thing?
Yes.
Okay, so there are many vegetables that are genetically modified by Monsanto, or they add certain pesticides and all that. They poison certain vegetables, but one of the most important ones is the corn. The corn comes from our people, the native people of this land, the Americas, of this continent. Our corn, we've been taking care of our corn. It's sacred to us. Our ancestors genetically modified, cross-pollinated plants to create this perfect plant. The corn, which is perfect in starch and carbohydrates. For thousands of years, we've been eating this corn. It's very sacred to us. And all of a sudden, a company comes along and they genetically modify what's sacred to us. That's a blow to our culture. That's a blow to our identity. So that's what we're here fighting for our corn. That's what belongs to us. It's our sacred plant.
Sure, Lauren Steiner.
Hi, Lauren. Now you're here today. You're protesting the TTP and Monsanto. What's that about? Don't you like feeding poor people?
Well, I only wish that it would feed poor people. The whole problem with the TPP is that it's bad for workers, bad for consumers, bad for the environment, and bad for national sovereignty. Specifically with Monsanto, which, by the way, is one of the companies that wrote the TPP.
They wrote it?
Well, in the sense that, okay, the TPP has been negotiated between trade representatives from 12 countries and 600 corporate executives, Monsanto being one of them. Over the last 8 years, not one member of the public, not one member of the press has been able to see the text, but these corporate executives have the text on their office computers. Congress is now finally able to see it, but they have to go into a basement They have to surrender their cell phones. They're not allowed to take notes. They're not allowed to bring a staff member with expertise unless that staff member has the highest security clearance, and they're not allowed to talk about what's in it. So it's so secret that the former trade negotiator, Ron Kirk, when asked by Reuters, why isn't it being made public, he said, because if the public knew what was in it, it could never be passed.
So that means it probably shouldn't be passed?
No, it shouldn't be passed, but listen, here's what happened. Yesterday, the Senate voted to give Obama fast-track approval. In addition to this...
What is fast-track approval?
Fast-track means, and this is a Nixon-era procedure that was first done in 1974, which bypasses the constitutional role of Congress. In other words, Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution gives Congress the power to regulate trade agreements by a two-thirds vote, right? So the fast-track basically abdicates that role and gives the authority to the president. So what happens is, if the House passes the fast-track bill, otherwise known as trade promotion authority, then Congress only has 90 days to look at this treaty. They can only vote it up or down. Their debate is limited to 20 hours on the floor. They cannot add any amendments. And it becomes this agreement that the president now has for 6 years. Which means that not only will the TPP get passed under it, but the Transatlantic Investment Partnership, the TTIP, and any other agreement that comes after it. And these agreements aren't really trade agreements, because we have bilateral trade agreements with most of these countries anyway. What they are is they're just a big corporate power grab for all the industries. Big Pharma gets to extend their patents on brand name drugs, which delays into the market low-cost AIDS drugs and cancer drugs. That might be life-saving. It enables Hollywood to extend their copyrights, which stifles innovation and could cause all sorts of fair use, what is now considered fair use. People could be dinged for copyright infringement. You know, and it supersedes, it threatens national sovereignty because of the ISDS clause, which stands for the Investor State Dispute Settlement Clause, which enables corporations to sue countries or any government, local, state, or federal governments, if they pass a law that affects the corporation's quote-unquote expected future profits.
So if the city of Los Angeles, for example, passed a livable wage law, the corporation could sue the city of Los Angeles?
Absolutely, if it's a foreign corporation. And this is already happening in many trade agreements. For instance, Quebec, a province in Canada, banned fracking. And Lone Pine Resources, an American company, is suing Quebec for $250 million. And Philip Morris is suing Australia and Uruguay for their plain paper packaging laws, because they have figured out that when you put a plain wrapper and just some horrible warning label and a picture of a diseased lung or something on a cigarette package, that young people will not smoke as much, right? So Philip Morris is suing Uruguay and Australia for that under, you know, as a copyright infringement.
I see.
Yeah.
And so, specifically though, you're also protesting Monsanto today. What's the biggest central issue on Monsanto?
Well, because of the ISDS clause that I just spoke about, it makes GMO labeling laws or GMO bans subject to elimination.
For instance, so if the United States had a law that said, if you've frankenized or slashed all the genes in this food, or if you've put some kind of poison in it, we can't force you to label that because the corporation can sue.
Right. And just this week, or I should say just last week, they sued for what's called the COLA, the country of origin labeling law, and they actually won in one of these courts. And now Tom Vilsack, the Secretary of Agriculture, is going around telling all the meat producers that they have to remove the fact that this is made in America. So people that are buying meat and poultry are now not going to know where their food is coming from, and it could come from these countries like Vietnam. The biggest risk, the worry about the TPP, because Vietnam is one of the countries, is that they are producing and selling tainted shrimp.
Right.
So right now we ban that tainted shrimp from coming into our markets. If the TPP passes, we can't do that.
And of course, we have a lot of meat packaging companies that have been recently bought by Chinese corporations, and they have a whole avian flu issue over there. Is that going to be a problem too?
Absolutely. I mean, right now we're talking about taking chickens, okay, live chickens, sending them over to China to be packaged because it's cheaper, the labor is cheaper there, and sending back the packaged chickens to the United States to be sold. In addition to how stupid that is, do you realize how much fossil fuels that wastes? Globalization, and Naomi Klein points this out really well in her new book. It's called This Changes Everything, Capitalism Versus the Climate. She talks about how during the 90s, those two decades were the decades of the advancement on the war on global warming and globalization. However, everything that happened with globalization, all these trade deals, were binding and mandatory. But any targets that were set in the global warming agreements were all voluntary and, you know, optional. So what's happened is, as free trade has increased, as globalization has increased, we have increased our greenhouse gas emissions because of all the shipping of these products, which is why we need to have a local food system, which is apparently one of the focuses of today's march.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Finance. Nice
Hi.
To meet you.
Nice to meet you.
So you're here today at the Monsanto protest.
Yes.
And Monsanto claims that, of course, their products are necessary to increase food yield and keep the whole world from starving. And why don't you want people to, like, have food so they won't starve?
Well, I don't believe that Monsanto is telling the truth about that. I believe that organic farming is really the way to go, and that the toxins involved in genetic engineered food are polluting the environment and actually doing more to harm people than to help them. Plus,
so you believe the scientific studies that show that yields are actually stable or down after 3 years of Monsanto products?
Exactly.
Right. Okay. Okay. And you have other concerns about the safety of the food itself?
I'm mainly concerned with the glyphosate that they are engineered to withstand, and the glyphosate is implicated in Alzheimer's and autism. Glyphosate is a pesticide.
Okay.
It's the main pesticide that Monsanto engineers their food to withstand.
Okay, so it's a pesticide that they produce, and then they engineer the food to withstand the pesticide that they produce.
Yes.
So they created a problem, solved the problem, and sell products on both sides.
Right, they want to sell more glyphosate, so they engineer products to withstand glyphosate so they can sell more of the toxic neurotoxin and poison the insects that infest plants.
Brilliant in a kind of Dr.
You know,
no
but
sort
then,
of way.
Yeah, but then the super weeds come out, so they need to use more glyphosate, and it becomes like, you know, a snake eating its own tail eventually, you know.
And so are there studies that show that these bioengineered products that resist the glyphosate are also poison to humans or other organisms?
I think that the studies that implicate that are hidden, and they have patents where they sell their product, and then you can't do any studies on that product. You have to sign a release that you will not do any scientific studies using the seeds that you buy from them.
I see.
And so the long-term studies that we need are just not being done.
I see.
And I think that scientists are not really interested in doing those studies because their future lies in biotech, and they want to make a living and support their families.
Right.
And so if they do those studies, they know that they're going to have a smear campaign launched against them to discredit the study so that Monsanto can sell more glyphosate or other biotech companies like Bayer and DuPont. You know, there's more than just Monsanto.
I thought Bayer made aspirin and DuPont made paint.
I think they all make, they all are involved in genetic engineering and in pesticides and chemicals.
Thank you.
I believe so.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you.